Power's back now on BBC One. It's New Year's Eve, the perfect time for a reunion.
I'm still not pregnant, and I'm still not
55 million records sold.
Do you wish you were a Spice Girl?
Stop it.
9 UK number one singer. But before we behold their vision of the future, let's take a look at their scintillating past.
Child, I saw music as an escape.
I don't think I had a concept in my head of me wanting to be on TV and famous and all that kind of stuff. That was never like a thing at the forefront of my mind at all.
I was a very realistic child. I either wanted to be an Olympic gymnast, a prima ballerina, or a pop star.
I never dreamt, really, that I could be a pop singer or in a band because I'd never seen anyone from my school do that. Too much of something is
bad enough. I wanted to perform, you know, I wanted to be a singer, or a dancer, or an actress. Stop right now, thank you very much.
I need somebody with a human touch. I went to Performing Arts College, and I moved away from home at 16. When I think about that now, it freaks me out. You know, it's so young. I went away to a college in Kent, Sidcup in Kent, Dorrienbeg College, and I studied there for 3 years.
30 people out of each year of my school got to do dance and drama and art and stuff like that. It wasn't a full performing arts school, but it was a school that for some reason had that programme.
I went to Lane Theatre Arts. I was nowhere near one of the best ever. But I worked harder and I would be in college before anybody else and I would be the last to leave because I just used what I had and pushed it as far as I could and I have a lot of determination.
I went to Stage School at 11. My mum and dad worked very hard for me to be able to go there because it was quite expensive.
And I would have loved to have gone to dance school, actually. I asked my mother, but we couldn't afford it at the time.
It was actually one day when I was auditioning to sing on a cruise ship that I got the flyer for an audition for a girl band.
Oh, my mum saw the ad for a girl group that she thought, oh, that would be interesting.
Tons and tons and tons of girls auditioned for it and everybody was there singing pop songs and I sang Mine Hair from Cabaret. Because all I'd ever really done was musical theatre. That was my training, that was my background.
Some of the greatest love of all, thinking I was Whitney Houston.
I sang I'm So Excited, Pointer Sisters. I sang that because it was one of the only songs I had sheet music for.
I saw this advert, but I went to Spain to see my grandmother, so I missed the audition.
None of us were probably the best at the audition. We were all just good in our own little way. We all had something different to offer.
And a couple of months later, I rang them up, going, are you still looking for girls? And he goes, yeah, come down, we're down to the last 12. And so I was like, okay, cool. Now, looking back, I was thinking, I wonder if I would have got in that last 12 from all those hundreds.
I wasn't at the original auditions. I came a little bit later.
Originally, there was another girl in the group called Michelle Stevenson. Michelle just didn't really fit in like the rest of us did.
They needed me to make it work.
Makes me want to be free in a world where we fly, fly, fly.
The people who put the ad in the paper were Chris and Bob Herbert.
They were the ones that wanted this girl group. And we were put in this house I think it might have been Maidenhead. And we were doing singing and we were dancing and we were just bonding.
Although initially it was a manufactured thing, it actually turned itself round and I think we truly became a band and actually really loved each other for real.
It was like, oh my God, finally I found my people that I can sit and relate to. Even though we're from all different walks of life, we have the same thing in common.
I can't imagine life without us now.
I know, yeah.
It's like, this is it, do you know what I mean? I've like adapted you like my new family.
We did become very close very quickly. Very close. Very quickly.
Melanie and Jerry. Melanie Brown is a really bossy one and so is Jerry.
They were both the really, really loud ones. They were incredibly vocal. When they got on, it was great. But when they didn't, you know, it was a power struggle.
You really spoiled the harmony line then. Really did.
But I think Emma had quite a sort of feisty little side to her, which was great. And I think she could slot right in the middle of the two of them quite comfortably.
You need to concentrate because you can get your timing when you concentrate.
I wanted to be like that, but it just wasn't me. Same as it wasn't Mel C. We were normally the bookends, me and Melanie.
I had this feeling that it was going to really work and it was going to be massive. And I realised that positivity was contagious. So I was always like, And then we all started to believe it. The other girls did too. And, you know, and we just kept that kind of spirit.
I'm so ambitious and I just want to get there. No. Really, that's the whole point of it. I just want my ego fed.
There's so much more work to do, yeah. And you actually put yourselves up on a pedestal sometimes.
We don't.
I think you do.
Nobody was like saying, you're good. We knew that we were good and we knew what we were. Because we'd look at, you know, you'd look to your sign and you'd be like, oh, God, she's great. We look great. But nobody was telling us that.
Because the other girls come from stage school. They kept on asking for a contract, right? They're going, when's the contract coming? When's the contract? And I remember driving along thinking, actually, it's good that we haven't got a contract.
We had such a vision and we wanted to write our own songs. We didn't want to be told what to do, what to wear, what to sing. We didn't want to be told anything.
We were in the house for the 9 months and we'd been writing and learning the same dance routines. We were like, come on, we want to get out there. We want to get some great writers on board, you know, to help us and producers. And we really pushed for a showcase. We were like, we're ready.
That was when people in the industry first got to see us and then that's when the buzz started. And to be honest with you, we wanted a contract, we wanted to sign something. Thank God we didn't, because we wouldn't have been able to get away scot-free.
And I remember packing all our stuff up in these bin liners and quickly put it in my car and just doing a bunk. We did this showcase and just through, you know, networking, connection, we ended up meeting Simon Fuller.
He'd negotiated record deals before. He had relationships within the business. And, you know, he was probably the best man for the job.
It took somebody that was not afraid to take the ball and run with it. You know, you had to have balls to take us on.
We knew that we'd found a great manager. And we went to Simon with, I think, probably about 6 written songs. We wrote Wannabe quite soon after the showcase with Richard Stannard and Matt Rowe. If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with my friends. I think we wrote it maybe in about 15, 20 minutes. Just 5 of us throwing ideas in.
You got it.
It was a bit silly and we, you know, he has all these silly little sayings that you do when you're like, there's a group of friends.
We didn't want to sing about what everybody else sings about. It was, there were so many songs out there and they've all got the same message. We wanted to say something different. You know, I mean, what does everybody think? You know, if you want to be my lover, you've got to get with my friends. If you want to be my
lover, yeah. It was so unique. It was like nothing you'd ever heard before. Just like, that is our first single, that is it. If you wanna be my lover, you have got to give.
Taking is too easy, but that's the way it is. This was 14th of July 1996, okay, and this was taken in my sister's back garden. Wannabe had gone to number 3, it was just gone in. And it was on a Sunday afternoon and we cracked open a bottle of bubbly and look, so we were doing like, yeah, it went to number 3. We were so excited by it.
And then I think we flew out to Japan like that very same day and was doing promotion over there, and then we heard it had gone to number one.
It was all so spontaneous and last minute. It was like, we have to get them through Top of the Pops. Oh, where are they? They're in Japan. Let's fly a crew over and film it. It was all so exciting. If you want to be my
lover, you gotta get with my friend. It was just, like, amazing. For a first single, and I think a bunch of girls that didn't really quite know what the hell was happening. You have got to give. Taking
is too easy, but that's the way you. For me, that was kind of like my life had begun, because that's what I wanted. I kind of knew that was going to happen. So when it eventually did, it was just like, here we go. Hold on tight. If you want to be my lover, you got to get with
my friends. It was incredible. It was everything that I ever dreamt of and more. And what was nice is we all really appreciated it as well. You have got
to give. It was affirming what we believed in ourselves.
I didn't look back and go, oh, God, last year I was on the dole, skin, eating toast out of tinfoil. We were all appreciative and very thankful, but we were on it, like a white-knuckle ride. Such excitement. We noticed that we were different from what was out there, because it was all boy bands. The whole pop industry was saturated with boy bands.
And we were constantly coming up against these barriers of, you know, it was all about boys, 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 boys. Boys sell records, boys sell videos, boys sell magazines. And we were like, well, no, come on, it's time to change. This is about girls. This is girl power.
We were very confident that we had a great second single, because we knew a song like Wannabe, One It Wonder, it's got One It Wonder written all over it. But we knew the rest of the album were probably better songs.
Save You There was quite a cool record. You know, it's a bit R&B, but still mainstream. Last time that we had this conversation,
I decided we should be friends. Hey. This is where boys started liking the Spice Girls too, because the video was a bit naughty and we all looked a bit hotter. And I think then our fan base grew.
I think that's really what turned us, actually, Save You There, that record. It turned us from a one-hit wonder to, actually, this is a band.
And when Save You There went straight into number one, it was like, yeah, we're flying.
I think that girls could relate to us. None of us were 6 foot tall, skinny, gorgeous girls. You know, we were normal looking girls that, you know, with a couple of hours in hair and makeup, brushed up all right.
The fact that we were really normal girls from really normal backgrounds, we wanted other girls to see that you can go out there and show people that your dreams can come true.
Girl power! Girl power!
Girl power to me was being a supportive, honest woman to another woman. You know what I mean? You get your mind straight, so there's no bitchiness, there's no jealousy, there's no dishonesty, and you learn how to support other women, encourage them, and be there as a real person.
It's all about, you know, females coming together, and we can do it, and, you know, doing it for the other girls out there, and blah, blah.
Girl power is, you know, it's about accepting the way that you are, having fun most importantly. And if you want to wear a short skirt and a wonder bra, wear it, but be sure about yourself and basically have a good time.
And don't let anybody control your life, because you control your run your lives.
You've got to have some balls in this life.
We had such big dreams. We didn't just want to sell records in England. You know, there are lots of bands that don't sell records past Dover. We weren't interested in that. We wanted to be big everywhere.
We wanted to be the biggest girl band in the world.
Spice Girls!
World domination.
Every single continent, number ones all over the world.
You are so big in Korea.
Again, it kind of happened very quickly.
I mean, worldwide success is fantastic, but you always want it in your own home, town, maybe. So to be huge in London is quite amazing.
When we turned up to do the Oxford Street Lights, I remember my parents used to take us up to London every Christmas to see the lights. The fact that I was there turning those lights on was just so exciting.
I remember the car pulled up and instead of us just going straight up like we were supposed to, we all just kind of ran and touched everyone. Touched the audience like, oh my God, you're here. Yeah.
I remember I picked up this little boy and in my shoulder, and it was just magic. You know, we felt really good arrived, I think.
Three, two, one!
It seems bizarre that probably only a year before that, the last time that we were in a lineup like that was when we was at the Dole office signing on.
But all that's left for me to say is this year's Christmas Top of the Pops belongs to the Spice Girls!
Success creates success and more work. So you never get time to enjoy like the moment. You suddenly go, okay, you've got to be ready for this thing, and then next thing. It's very hard to take it in. So we're always like, you know, on a mission going to the next, you know, working towards that.
We were having fun. That's the main thing. It wasn't, we've got to keep this going. We had a laugh everywhere that we went. And we used to make people smile. We really did. We were funny. We had a good sense of humour. We had great music and people liked the music.
Ginger, sporty, scary, baby and posh, the all-conquering Spice Girls!
Oh my God, the Brits in 97 were just insane. We opened the show with Who Do You Think You Are? That's when we were on top of the world. Those were like the real great moments.
I hadn't worked out what I was going to wear. And I had this stylist bring me this little tight black dress. And I was like, a bit boring, isn't it? And I said, well, why don't I put a Union Jack flag on it? And she went, no, that's racist. And I was like, what? I said, that's stupid. So I put a peace sign on the back. And so I got my sister to stitch. It was a proper tea towel onto that dress. And then I car sprayed, and it was car paint, and my boots red.
At the time, I just thought, wow, that's a nice dress. And she obviously got a huge amount of publicity from wearing that. I was just like, wow, that's great. Jerry's on the front page of all the newspapers. But if she is, then that's great for the whole band.
And the winner of the Box Best Video Award is, thank you, God, the Spice Girls for Stay Your Winner.
We're nearly falling out tonight.
And I had this other dress that I wore to pick up the award. It was like a sequin dress. Because I was quite, like, clumsy, and I think, like, my boob fell out. You know, it caused not the kind of dress I suppose you want.
I don't think that Jerry would ever have done anything like have one of her boobs out to get attention. I don't. I mean, I think at this time, the media were jumping on anything. You know, and if one of us did have a low plunge top, I think that they would pick up on that.
They love that kind of stuff, don't they? So really, I was more of a media package for them in that respect. I was always making mistakes and, you know, putting my foot in it or doing something.
Start from scratch in America. You know, you can't expect to have success in England, Europe or Japan or anywhere and then automatically crack it here.
Of course, we were very, very nervous.
All a bit mad here, isn't it?
But I knew we could do it.
We're doing like 12 or 13 radio interviews in a morning.
Have you got any friends?
But, you know, girl power did spread to America and we had huge amount of success here. Wannabe was number one in America.
Spice Girls are on the Empire State.
Americans are different to English. English want to say, yeah, well done, but we're going to bring you down at any point. Where Americans are like, yeah, go for it and go for it. And that to me was like more of a rather than the number one.
The story so far is that we have had to drive around the hotel 4 times because of these little critters in the taxi behind us. Here's one. Head down, cover it up, there he is.
It's just a bizarre feeling, it really is. You know, we couldn't go anywhere without being recognised.
And I'm so glad, actually, that I did have my mates with me doing the same thing, because otherwise I think I might have gone a bit doolally.
Let me get me some food, please, honey.
Everything to do with the Spice Girls, that life, once it began, it was surreal. Everything was surreal. And you just, like anything in life, you just get on with it, you know, and it was brilliant and it was exciting, but it was also hard to get your head around it. I don't know if there's a full acceptance, you just go along, you know, you're just on the ride. That's how it felt. Like, it's quite unnerving, really. And as I've got older, and when that feeling comes back again, it makes me feel very vulnerable, because it's, you're not, you know, you haven't got your feet on the ground.
Well, I've got my clothes on to chill. Oh, shut it. Oh, God. Topless pictures of me had come out. Hideous. It was not good then.
Jerry had told us about her, you know, her glamour modelling and the stuff that she'd done before, so we were all fully aware of it, and we all knew that it was going to come out.
This is when it all starts going a bit... Yeah. I'd done glamour pictures when I was, like, 18 or 19, and they were quite harmless, do you know what I mean? It was just my boobs.
My nephews and my cousins were watching us and like, yeah, girl power, you know, and it was all very young, definitely at the beginning. So for those pictures to come out, it was a bit scary.
We were selling records to children and teenagers and adults, but children were the main ones buying our records at one time. And I think we were all a bit concerned that that might affect our fan base. So I think it probably did cause a little bit of friction.
I remember being mad about it.
I look at it now completely differently to how I did then. But, you know, I think we overcome that. We never said, don't forget, we never said we're perfect. Never. And everybody has some sort of past.
When we met Prince Charles and, you know, he seemed very happy to meet us, and that's when you kind of think, this is bizarre, you know, people like this are wanting to meet us.
I just thought, oh, what a sweet guy. That's nice. And more than anything, I was like, oh, wait till they see that. My mum and dad and people that I know and that I grew up with in Leeds, that was, like, exciting for me. Not the fact that I was personally meeting him, but look, oh, I've just got pictured with Mum.
I pinched his bum, ended up all over the newspaper.
It took me a very long time to wipe a certain amount of lipstick off one or two cheeks here this evening.
So I think that night in Manchester when we met Prince Charles was... it was really good fun. I have to be completely honest, you know, my mind wasn't totally on the performance that night, because that was when I first met David. And Manchester United, the team, and Alex Ferguson were going to that event, and they were going to be sitting in the audience watching.
We flew to South Africa and then we met Nelson Mandela.
What do you think of the Spice Girls? Well,
you know, he just said it was an honour to meet us.
It's one of the greatest moments in my life.
Hey! I mean, you just think, hold on a minute, stop this, what's going on?
We were all very aware of who Mr. Mandela was, and I think the fact that he knew who we were was just incredible.
You know what I did? Is I pinched a loo roll and put each square in like a bag to give to the makeup artist, and the hair and makeup was like, look, there's a bit of Nelson Mandela's house. But I told him, I said, you do know that I've nicked some of your toilet roll and some of your stones in that plant pot to give to the hair and makeup outside. He was like, oh, you're so funny.
I mean, moments in my head, I think, okay, today I'm going to dress like a lady, you know, and this is an important occasion. And then we met him, and the Watford girl would always come out.
Well, you must realise, of course, that they are talking about an old man.
You're not old. You know, you're as young as the girl you feel, and I'm 25.
I think at the time when we met Prince Charles and Nelson Mandela, we were just in this huge whirlwind, and life was so surreal anyway that it was just another day at the office.
Finally, fans of the Spice Girls will soon be allowed to see what their idols are really, really like. The group used the Cannes Film Festival to announce their first film appearance in Spice the Movie.
I can't remember it being, oh, and now we have to make a movie. It'd be like, oh, that'd be fun to do. Yeah, why not?
This is what our movie should be about. They're young, they're cute, they're hip, they're wacky.
Yeah, but can they act?
It wasn't acting. We was genuinely just being ourselves.
Why do people stereotype us all the time?
Ah, practically all of the stuff in the movie was us.
I'm so sporty!
I was just playing myself and was playing herself. And it was kind of heightened with the writing, obviously.
My mummy's my best friend.
I thought Victoria did really well in it. I thought I was really crap in it, actually.
You either got to move it in front or move it out of the way.
All right, well, I'll move that fairground horse to there. Sort that out.
You can't do that.
Says who?
Says Mr. Chess. It's been in the rules for thousands of years.
And also, I felt really, it was rushed, and I wanted to be, like, do deep acting. It just felt like we were just knocking it out.
They're a problem, officer.
Dangerous driving, criminal damage, flying a bus without a licence, and, frightening the pigeons.
It's one of those times that I kind of don't remember much about, apart from just being in lots of different outfits and singing and not getting much sleep.
What do I say? I'm really sorry, officer, but the thing was we were late for a show, so we were in a hurry. We didn't hurt anybody, and we're just really sorry. We promise never, ever to do it again.
You know, we weren't expecting Oscars out of it. It was what it was. It was great fun. People loved it. The music in it was great. That was all the songs from the second album.
The second album was actually written during the time we were filming the film.
Down in Dirty City used to be their home, I thought would be better. Right?
We had a mobile studio on set, so when you're not rehearsing your lines or you're not on camera, you're in the studio writing a song and singing that's right there next to your Winnebago.
We should do it, we've got to do that one. Shiggy, shiggy,
shiggy, haga! There were really, really good days. We had so much fun. But there were some days that were absolutely awful, and I've never laughed so much, but I've also never cried so much.
We were together so much. You know, it's like being with somebody 24 hours a day. At some point during that day, they're going to say something where you go, oh, you get a little bit offended, but, you know, you have to carry on.
I remember being really shouted at by Jerry quite a few times because I didn't think what she was saying was right. And sometimes she would think everything she said and did was, you know, was how it should be. And of course, that's not true.
I know I probably upset them at times, and it's horrible thinking that, you know, that if I made them cry or anything like that, but sometimes I think it's because I was the eldest one, I automatically was trying to make a thought I knew what the right thing was, a decision or something. And so I thought, you know, it was for the greater good if we'd do something. So sometimes I'd maybe be too bossy and say, come on, we've got to do it like this, but thinking actually they're going to feel better in the long run.
I think between the five of us, we all handled pressure really different. Some handled it like this, some handled it like that. My way of dealing with my pressure was to be as obnoxious as possible and slightly angry.
But there was times when Melanie was very mean to me. I suppose, you know, there were times, well, like ganging up on people as well. It's kind of playground stuff, you know, but in quite an extreme situation, which is hard.
What are we going to do now?
For tonight's special report, we take a look at one of Britain's most successful exports, a marketing phenomenon that's earned £100 million worldwide in less than a year.
Next wave.
I remember saying to Simon Fuller once, you know, we want to be as famous as Purse Automatic. We want to be a household name.
There's part of you that thinks, wow, this is so cool, Pepsi commercial, we're on bags of crisps.
This is what I want, what I really, really want.
We're on, you know, everything. We did all these adverts and it was really good fun and we became household names like we've always wanted.
Baby. At one point, I remember thinking, I've done more adverts than music videos in the last couple of months.
We're ready then, girls. We're going to go for it.
We would be doing it in the middle of something, of
you know, maybe creative.
We're really looking forward to working with all you nutters at Pepsi, so beware.
And at the end of the day, if we really didn't want to do something, all five of us could have said, we're not doing it. And that rarely happened.
But I think it got to the point where it just felt like a bit of an extreme and maybe other things were beginning to suffer. See ya, hotel. Not that we were ever taken, you know, completely seriously as a music act, but, you know, maybe we were losing a little bit of respect from people because we were selling out.
Here we go!
Our first live show was in Istanbul. I think we did two nights there. And from, you know, doing the odd TV here and there to doing a huge arena and doing a full-length show, everything you'd ever dreamed of, you know, with zero experience of that.
So it was exciting for us, but it was also good for us to actually prove to people, look, we can sing. Everyone's always going to want to be negative, especially in the UK. And this was our chance to say, hey, look, we can sing.
That arm. It was frightening. There's no place to hide. You can't be airbrushed. You can't, you know, you can't hide. You can't hide your voice. You can't hide your dancing.
I would almost be in the dressing room going, can we just go, like, get out there, like, now? Why do we have to wait for anyone? They all need to take their seats, Melanie. Well, tell them to hurry up. I couldn't wait to get out there.
We were standing next to Victoria and the screen was going up. I mean, I was looking at her, she's looking at me, and I'm thinking, oh my God, I'm scared. She goes, all right. She goes, oh, don't worry, they're only coming here to see your big hair and your big boobs anyway if you go wrong.
So many doubters, it's great because people's expectations are so low that you'd have to be pretty dismal to live up to their expectations. So we knew we were going to go out there and just show everybody what we were made of.
Fame definitely affected us all in different ways. Some good, some bad, and some people have been more vocal about how it affected them than others have.
My biggest fear, and it made me feel nauseous just thinking about it, was the papers were going to say that I'd put on weight.
You know, I was called Podge Spice. Basically, I was the fat, dumpy one, you know, through the media, pointed out, you know, and obviously, you know, any imperfection is completely blown out of proportion.
All through the Spice Girls, I was, you know, terribly in control of what I was eating. I wasn't eating properly. And I was exercising, overly exercising, and I was very skinny.
I think there was one time that I think we were in Japan, and we all, you've got to understand, everyone's tired, we're exhausted. You know, we hadn't had a day off. And I think that night I'd, you know, made myself sick and I felt terrible. And in the morning I said to the girls, you know, I'm bulimic.
I found, you know, having an eating disorder really embarrassing. I was so embarrassed about it.
Even though we were that close, there's certain things, and with every woman, that you just don't talk about unless you feel like there's a window in there.
I wasn't ready to talk about it. And, you know, and I found, and I think lots of people in that situation, if somebody does approach you about it, you just, you know, keep them at arm's length. Too much of something is bad enough, but something's
so there was a point, OK, where we didn't have a day off for a year. I can remember thinking, OK, when's the next day off? And it was just, like, a horrendous amount of... And it was, like, 70 flights in a month. It was just ridiculous how much we were flying.
We've arrived in Granada!
Reality was hitting home then at how hard it was, how physically and emotionally demanding it all was. So sometimes I think maybe the excitement and the joy of everything, we didn't feel that fully because of the exhaustion.
And I remember my mum at one point phoning Simon Fuller and saying, the girls need a break. You know, we hadn't had any days off. We'd be getting up really early in the morning to catch flights. And my mum said, these girls are going to burn out. They really need a day off.
It's a really fine line of trying to manage people personally and then equally manage them professionally. So on one hand, he's saying, yeah, I want to make lots of money for these girls, da-da-da, go for it, because that makes us happy, but equally, not to the detriment of their health.
he was our manager, so of course he was like, I think we should do this and I think we should do that, and he, you know, there was that feeling of putting too much on the five of us.
I kind of pretty much kept it to myself, but I wasn't really that happy being with Simon anymore. But of course, you know, the most vocal ladies were the ones that really made it come to fruition.
We were in this house in France, and I was in the laundry room with Victoria, and I looked at her and she looked at me, and we just thought, we've got to get rid of him. There was some, you know, we just felt cross, like he was not allowed in the gang anymore.
I can't remember it being one set thing as to why he got fired. It was a combination of tittle-tattle here, there and everywhere. And I think one of the things for me, like I said before, is he was trying to control too much.
Oh, what a crazy, crazy time. You know, we're on top of the world, you know, biggest bands in the world, got everything going for us. We've got a tour planned, a world tour, and we decide to leave our manager, as you do.
Then we had to start employing people and finding people, and so it's us lot running the show, and it's like six-year-olds driving a lorry.
It was really, really stressful because what we created, you know, it was us. It was us. It was our baby, and we cared so much about it.
As Victoria said, we've had a manic year. We're the first band ever to go to number one with our first four singles. Wannabe also reached number one in America. We did our first film, Spice World, the movie, which is out tomorrow. We met Prince Charles, Nelson Mandela, and more recently, the Queen. In Istanbul, we performed our very first and one-off concert, which was an amazing experience. We'll be touring next year, which is a completely new show. And if you weren't in Istanbul, here's your chance to see it for yourself.
We spent that Christmas and New Year in Dublin. And that's where we rehearsed for our tour, which our world tour. And we started there at the point in February 98.
The start of the tour, the five of us were the tightest we've ever been because, again, we didn't have management. We'd actually really connected again, and it felt like we were starting all over again, if that makes any sense. I remember being on a private jet.
We're getting on the mini plane!
Me and Jerry actually were sitting opposite each other. We landed and Jerry got up and went, I'm going to say bye, girls. Girls, I'm going to say bye now. And I thought, well, that's really weird. We never say goodbye to each other because we're not, you know, we go home for a couple of hours and we're back together.
You know something, you just think, well, that's a bit odd, the way somebody says goodbye to you.
Thanks for coming along. It's really nice to see you all, but are we not missing somebody?
We are. Unfortunately, Jerry's not very well tonight, so get well soon, Jerry.
I think we came up with, well, let's just say she's ill and just feel it out for a minute to see if she's going to come back at all. That's what I was hoping for anyway.
It was all kicking off. There's phone calls here. We were ringing her. You know, Lois were ringing us. And we spoke to her on that day and we were like, what are you doing, you silly cow? Come on, just come back, you know.
I don't think we actually thought that she'd left.
Jerry Halliwell, otherwise known as Ginger Spice, has announced she's left the Spice Girls, ending days of speculation about her future.
I remember knowing in my heart days approaching that I was going to leave, and there was the song Viva Forever, and I was like standing there and I was thinking, oh my God, this is the last time I'm going to sing this with these girls. I can't do it anymore. I just felt empty and I'd given them everything I could. I just felt like the band had got so big, and you know, and the girls, you know, were almost like they didn't need me anymore, really. And yeah, I definitely felt very redundant, and like the wheels were turning whether I was there or not, it felt.
Everybody in the band's needed. God, it wouldn't be able to function, you know, without us all being there for each other.
The story goes that she always got going to do, or she wanted to do something to do with breast cancer, but Mel B wouldn't let her in. And I don't know that story. I don't remember any of that.
And I say it was, you know, they said that they didn't want me to do this breast cancer interview alone, and that kind of did it for me. I was like, I can't even do that by myself. That was kind of like the final straw. But I think it was an amalgamation of, like, I just felt I didn't belong anymore.
At first, personally, again,
as a friendship thing, I was distraught. I was so upset. But professionally, we had to make it work. We had to move on, move forward.
My number one thing was, right, she's gone for whatever reason. She's got her reasons, which must have been quite serious and heavy in her mind. We have a whole show to do with one person missing. We now have to re-choreograph the dance routines and dish out the lyrics and the lines. That's when my brain automatically went to that.
Here in Miami.
How long was the flight? 9 hours.
So we feel really good.
I think we had like a couple of weeks or a week or however long off before we went to America.
Jerry leaving the group only 2 weeks ago.
And we just didn't know whether they'd want a four-piece. You know, people have bought tickets to see 5 Spice Girls.
80% of the Spice Girls will be performing tonight, and we'll see if they have the staying power to make up for that missing 20%.
Luckily, they were cool. They said, you know, we still want to see the Spice Girls. So we were okay, but she could have really f***ed things up for us.
It was never the same when she left. And other members might say, oh, it was great, we could do more complicated dance moves, we could sing more. It's like, that's not what we were about. We were about a vibe. We was about 5 girls.
Victoria and Melanie found out they were pregnant quite early on in the American Idol tour.
Very happy for you both.
I'd found out I was pregnant. Melanie B decides to do a pregnancy test. So we're all in the toilet and she's weeing on this stick. And then she's like, wee, fly. And we're like, okay, Melanie. She's like, she's got this pregnancy test. And there was just wee flying everywhere. And it was just a genius moment. And that was just proof that we did everything together. We went through everything together, even taking pregnancy tests and then sharing the urine with the entire room.
You knew for a while, you know, because you want to keep it quiet for as long as you can. So they were getting these little tiny bumps and puking all over the place, and nobody knew why.
Wembley was huge. And all I remember thinking was, wow, I'm so excited to be here. I think I was like 4 months pregnant. I remember thinking, I really just need to pee all the time.
I watched them go and do Wembley. It was so painful.
Well, that's her own fault. Look at you there.
It's funny because I watched one of the songs on YouTube a few weeks ago and I was just looking at myself and I was just thinking, who is that? You know, I really didn't recognise myself. You know, when you see yourself do something, you know, obviously I've seen myself a lot on film and stuff, you think, oh, I remember that now. I don't remember being that person. It's weird.
At the end of the tour, obviously, the babies were going to be coming along and we decided just to, you know, have a little respite and take some time out.
Melanie B had already had a solo single with Missy Elliott and Victoria was working on solo stuff, as was Emma. You know, we were all doing little solo things here and there.
But we also knew that we wanted to do another album and we had lots of ideas.
We were looking forward to it. We were going to work with different producers for the first time, American producers.
There was something in this album that actually it was quite special. Lyrically, we talked about each other and we talked about Jerry leaving with Goodbye. You know, so there was all our feelings were coming out on this album.
But when it came down to, you know, writing and recording the third Spice Girls album, my solo album was out there, and I decided that that's what I wanted to do.
I just remember her saying, I won't be there for the full recording of the third album because I'm working on my own stuff. And I was like, whatever you want to do, you do. You can't force somebody to come in and sing and be Sporty Spice when they're not feeling it.
And she was recording the material at different times to us. So it was myself, Melanie B and Emma were recording. Jerry had left, and Melanie C would come in at different times to do her vocaling.
You know what? I was fragile. I was ill at that time. You know, I was suffering with depression as well as, you know, trying to get over my eating disorder. So I suppose I didn't have the strength to deal with it. To be honest with you, I think that's probably what it was.
I think that I feel ashamed of myself that I didn't show Melanie C. That I didn't give her more time. I didn't realise that she had issues that she had.
I wish with all of them that maybe, you know, we'd all sat down and talked about personal things a little bit more and how everyone was and what kind of headspace individually we were all in.
The third album was still a big success. We had Holler, which was number one. Goodbye, again, which was number one.
If everybody was honest, it wasn't how it was. And everybody had their own things going on then, and, you know, I think it was time to move on.
Together, this British group has more tattoos and shoes and news headlines and more fans across the globe than any other.
We got an award for outstanding contribution to music at the Brits in 2000, which I think was very deserved, even though at that moment in time I didn't really want to be a Spice Girl, but I was still incredibly proud of everything we'd achieved.
We totally achieved world domination for a short period of time. I'm very proud of that. I'm proud of the songs that we wrote together, and I'm proud that we have changed a lot of women.
I don't think, probably in my heart, I ever felt like it would end. No, I knew that people wanted to go off and we wanted to have solo careers, but I probably always thought that we'd come back together and then we'd go off again and we'd come back together.
In my mind, we'd never split up. We'd taken a break because we all have individual lives and we're all older. And there's things that we want to do personally. But for me, we never broke up.
We've all got to say a big, big thank you to Jerry, because without her, we wouldn't be able to have done this.
Big up the Jerry's Spice!
Come on! 21 minutes to 9. Now then, brace yourself for this. Posh, sporty, baby, scary
Thursday,
and ginger.
June 28th, and today the Spice Girls are expected to tell us they're going to reunite for a tour.
Rumour has it that the Spice Girls are expected to announce they're going to get together again here.
A news conference is starting soon at the O2 Arena in London.
It wasn't until a week before that we really knew it was going to happen. And for me, I didn't believe it was going to happen until I'm actually in the same room.
Don't know.
I'd seen Emma, Jerry and Victoria quite recently before that, so I knew I was cool with them. But I hadn't seen Melanie for a few years, and I was scared.
We're all a bit older and a bit wiser and more experienced. And I think it was almost like a relief, like, oh, we're back together again, I'm not doing it by myself anymore.
I was carrying my baby and I was actually really excited the fact that my baby was with me on that day. It was quite a special moment.
You look amazing.
Oh, you do.
Thank you.
Hello.
I think we're all just happy to be back together, and think out of all the girls, it's myself and Jerry who probably appreciate being in the group more than anybody. Not because of the music, but literally just on a personal level about having our friends around us.
I cannot tell you how excited, how proud and joyful I felt to see those girls together.
Jerry had a christening for her baby, Bluebell, and I'm godmother, and so is Emma. We were all there except for Melanie B, and we had a laugh. And then literally the day after, it was myself, Jerry and Emma that started just talking about it, and wouldn't it be fun? We should think about getting back together.
I always knew we were going to get back together. There was never a question in my mind. You ask any of the girls, and I was always the one that's going, oh, yeah, in a few years, or, yeah, we're back on top.
Okay,
centre,
let's all do
centre. I was like, no way. No effing way. I am never, ever going to do it ever again, as long as I live.
Please welcome, in person for the first time together in 9 years, since Ginger did a bunk in Oslo, Posh, Ginger, Sporty, Baby, Scary, the one and only Spice Girl!
That we had that day was brilliant. The media thing that we had to address, that was kind of fun and games for us.
This is a question for Melanie C. As recently as April, you were still saying, I'm not going to rejoin the Spice Girls. So what changed?
Well, a girl's allowed to change her mind. And also, you know, this is something that we've only seriously started discussing this year, yeah. Really. And yeah, you know, I think all of us have had our fears and doubts.
You know, for Mel C, I think she's had great success with her solo career.
I'm happy doing my thing. I had stuff planned. I've had a record out. I've been promoting that. So, you know, I was busy and my life is very, very simple. And I like it that way.
I did have to go, it would just be so wonderful though. Don't you want to be back on stage with the Spice Girls? And I think once she'd really thought about it, you know, and I think once she thought maybe, you know, I can have a bit of both, then, you know, she was up for it.
So much time's moved on and all the old crap, it's gone. You know, all the stuff we had to deal with, it's gone. And if it rears its ugly head, then I will be the first to eradicate it.
This reunion is, you know, it was about reconciliation. It should be the reconciliation tour. It felt very natural that Simon Fuller would manage us again. He has an understanding of how we like to work.
I think Simon has wanted the Spice Girls to do this reunion for a long time. And I think we've waited until now for a reason. It's not been the right moment until now for any of us. And none of this would have been possible without him. And he's great at what he does, and we're all so much more grown up now. And we can appreciate and understand why he did some of the things that he did back then. We were young, and we, you know, we wanted to rule the world.
We were just excited at the concept of making it as big as it could be again.
You must be yourselves, disgust.
No.
I think, of course, we're going to be nervous, but I think it's excited more than anything.
Excited.
We can't wait to get in rehearsals, get up there. It's going to be brilliant.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
As most of us have been trained in dancing, it does take Jerry that little bit longer to pick up the dance routine. So we had a choreographer come over to London.
You know, I really respect Jerry for taking extra time at home, because you have to remember that the four of us, me, Mel, Emma and Victoria, we all danced from being kids. And Jerry never did any of that.
In 2 weeks' time, we're going to be rehearsing as a five-piece for the first time in 10 years. Can you imagine?
Rehearsals, all five of us are together, but unfortunately there was a bit of a spanner in the works, and it was me, because I've hurt my knee. My old injury is playing up again. It's quite scary and very, very frustrating for me, because I want to be up there and I want to learn those dance routines and I want to be giving it loads.
We're going to be in rehearsals here in LA for a month. And that's not long, because I've got a lot to learn.
At first, when they said to me I was going to have to rehearse in LA, I was a bit concerned because obviously just having the baby, I wanted to kind of be at home. But now, you know, he's 2.5 months. I think it's going to be lovely to get out and take him to rehearsals with me.
We have a huge undertaking, right? It's like about 20, over 20 songs to do in a short time, a few weeks.
But normally, how long does it normally take?
About 3 months to put together a tour like this. So we're kind of jamming it in 2 months. But you are the Spice Girls here once again to save the world.
And we always wing it.
I have complete and utter faith that those girls, including myself, will pull it out of the bag.
Anyone having trouble feeling that buzzy feeling when you make the sound?
No. Melanie has always been the disciplinarian.
We don't laugh in that in choreography.
Sorry.
This has to be taken as seriously as in there. Okay, I want to say that before.
I know.
And I might have to split some of you up.
I'm so excited about it now. I wasn't so much a couple of months ago. I was nervous about it. But now, having spent more time with the girls and seeing the rehearsals, I'm so excited.
Positivity. Colors of the world.
Spice up your life.
Every boy and every girl.
Spice up your life.
People of the world.
Spice up your life.
On the 1st of December, the show will have to be completely running smooth and finished. Costumes, lighting, vocals, dance routines, everything has to be perfect. It has to be.
1st of December is our full dress rehearsal, which I'm sure is going to be quite stressful. But it's going to be exciting as well.
Now then. It's always like this mad panic. You know, that's show business, you know, getting everything done. It always works out. We hope.
The full production rehearsal is the day before the show, so not much time to change anything or get things right. It was really good. We feel very good. As you can see, in my fetching outfit, out of Cavalli into whatever this is. But yeah, it's okay. It was hurting a little bit at the beginning. But I'm just, I'm taking care of it, I'm icing and things.
And then the 2nd of December is our first live concert back after 10 years. With all five of us.
I can't believe it's happening. Part of me is like, oh my God.
I'm really special.
But I never thought I'd be doing another Spice Girl concert.
But,
you?
No. What were you just saying? How lucky are we?
Yes, yeah.
To be
yes.
in this position, to be able to do this.
We are lucky.
We've always been in each other's lives, but not seen each other for a while. But to get really close again is really special.
It's very powerful. I feel very powerful when I'm with these four.
We've made an amazing memory, a new one to take on to when we're grandmothers.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yeah, definitely.
It is the truth. When we come together, something
magic
happens.
Should we go and
happens.
Start then, girls?
We better go and do
Let's
it.
Let's do it. When I was a Spice Girl the first time round, I believed in the Spice Girls, you know, I fought for the Spice Girls. And now I'm back, I feel like that again.
Listen to everyone screaming!
Just to be out there again and, you know, look to the left and right of me and see the other girls, that's all I can wish for, really.
Look how brown she is. Just have a look how brown she is.
Melody, I mean Jerry.
Brown girl in the ring.
Brown girl.
And the fact that I'm back with the girls, I think I'm going to cry through the whole thing because I am genuinely happy to be back and have that support around me.
I'm cracked with words when it comes to stuff like that because it's breathtaking for me.
Let's go, let's go.
I feel overwhelmed emotionally that it's actually happening, you know, 10 years later. That I'm actually on the stage with my four bandmates.
Yeah!
I mean, that makes me want to cry, actually, thinking about it.
See you on the other side!
Back on stage for the first time since 1998, Radio 2 has highlights from the Spice Girls in concert now. Or stay with us on BBC One, 2007's Going Out in Style for the EastEnders.
When you're feeling sad and low, we will take you where you gotta go. Smiling, dancing, everything is free.
Okay, go. Oh, just pull, Darren.
Thank you.
I'm so sorry, Sir George Michael.
I will kill you, Dad! Fucking come back! Come back! Straight back! Come on!
Don't miss out this Christmas. BBC iPlayer lets you watch programmes from the last 7 days on your computer. BBC iPlayer, making the unmissable unmissable.
Cast and crew, thank heavens for Geraldine. It's the Vicar of Dibley's story at 8:35. First on BBC One, New Year's Eve in the Square always ends